Hey everybody, Merry Christmas from Pixie and Abby and the beautiful Kelly. So this is the Taylor annual Christmas celebration today. This year it's just Kelly and I, but a little sneak peek into our happy birthday Jesus celebration. Hey Alexa, resume.
And lights and the presents are nice, but the real gift is you. Happy birthday,
Jesus,
Jesus. I'm so glad it's
Christmas.
Christmas.
Happy birthday, Jesus. We're so glad you came.
I'm so glad it's Christmas.
Are you singing, Abby?
And
Are you singing? Yeah. Are you singing, Abby? Bless you. Alexa, stop.
So now we're going to sing the actual Happy Birthday, Jesus, and blow out the candle. So happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jesus. Happy birthday to you. And many more for eternity. Yay! So, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Lord, we just thank you so much for this day to remember that you came into a world, a dark and hurting world that was longing for a savior. Many people over the centuries have argued about this and that and whether Christmas is actually your birthday and these kind of things and that, Lord. But Lord, we just take this day, no matter what the exact day in history is. We count it as today, Lord, December 25th, and we say that you came into this world to save us from our sins and give us a pathway to heaven, Lord. And because you loved us so much, you came as a human being to walk this life out with us. And we thank you so much for that. And then to sacrifice yourself to pay for our sins that only a divine sacrifice could do, a perfect, sinless lamb. Thank you. We're so honored, Lord, and I know so many things happen on this day, and there's a lot of things, a lot of focuses on Christmas gifts and Santa Claus and this and that, Lord, and they all have their beauty in each of those things, Lord. But may we have always remember, may we always remember that you are first and foremost the reason for the season, and that you came to give us a life. And a life more abundant than we could ever imagine. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's sing a couple Christmas carols. go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. While shepherds kept their watching o'er silent flocks by night, behold, throughout the heavens there shone a holy light. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. The shepherds fear and tremble when low above the earth rang out the angel chorus that filled our Savior's birth. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Thank you, Jesus. I know I never seem to remember all the verses to that song, huh? We'll get it one of these years, right? Okay, now let's sing one of our all-time favorites, right? Just lightly. Lift all honor up to you, Lord. May it be a heavenly sound. Away in a manger, no crib for a bed, the little Lord Jesus lay down his sweet head. The stars in the bright sky looked down where he lay. The little Lord Jesus asleep on the hay. The cattle were lowing, the baby away. But little Lord Jesus, no crying he makes. I love thee, Lord Jesus, look down from the sky and stay by my bedside till morning is nigh. Beneath me, Lord Jesus, I ask thee to stay. Close by me forever and love me, I pray. Bless all the dear children in thy tender care, and bend us for heaven to live with thee there. Thank you, Jesus. Okay. Now here's the story of all stories. And it came to pass in those days that a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. And this census first took place while Quirinius was governing Syria. So all were to be registered, everyone to his own city. Joseph also went up from Galilee out of the city of Nazareth into Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed wife, who was with child. So it was that while they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord showed around them, and they were greatly afraid. The angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. There's born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be the sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger." And suddenly there was an angel, a multitude of angels, of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." So it was when the angels had gone away from them into heaven that the shepherds said to one another, "Let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us." And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. Now when they had seen him, they made widely known the saying which was told to them concerning the child. And all those who had heard marveled at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. And then the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all things that they had heard and seen as it was told them. Y'all, listen. I know life can be stressful, and it can be frustrating. It can be hurtful. Things can just break you. But if you really, really and truly, if you really and truly look at the things the Lord has done for you throughout your life, the times that he's been there for you, you can't help but give him praise. And it's those times that he's been there for you that you have to remember. When things are hard, it's the times that he's been there for you that will help get you through. He sacrificed everything and came to this earth to make it so that you would never, ever have to worry about how things are going to end. He came so that you could have assurance that when it was your time on this earth was finished, that you could have a place to go that would be joy everlasting. But that while you're here, you can have a life that, yeah, it may have some struggles in this broken world, but you can have a life where you have a God that walks with you. He's God with us. That's what Emmanuel means. God with us. He will walk through you. He will walk with you through this life. And if you let him, he'll give you a life that's more abundant than you could have ever known. Today is the day that represents the day Jesus came into this world as a human. Rejoice and be glad in it, for it is the day that the Lord has made. He loves you, and we love you. You know, we have this book recently that's come into our possession, and this, I encourage you to get it. I can't possibly read this whole thing to you, but it's called The Christmas, The Rest of the Story by Rick Renner. And it's a beautiful book that talks about the history of Christmas and the Nativity and true historical events that have been actually documented about Christ and the Holy Family, Mary and Joseph and Jesus and the place of birth and nativity and all that stuff that we think oftentimes is fantasies and historic fairy tales that the world says, but there's actual historical proof of Jesus's birth and his family that was recorded in the early centuries by people like the mother-in-law of an emperor at the time went to Bethlehem to record actual information from family members of the Holy Family and stuff like that. So I'll read something to you just to give you an idea. Okay. So we don't know, a lot of you know about different Bible stories and hey, Mary and Joseph are the father and Jesus and different characters in the Bible and stuff like that. But do you really know like who they are? And this is something beautiful about this book. And this is something I plan every year to read to our kids and grandkids pieces out of this so that they understand the truth and validity of the Jesus, his birth and his life and that it is a real event. And it's important that we understand it's a real event because when we don't believe it's actually real and that it's just a story, we can't take it seriously and have a relationship with the God that came to earth. Okay. We can have a relationship with this, with God, with Jesus, if we truly believe he existed. Okay. So, one thing, Joseph, we all understand Joseph to be his earthly father, but not his actual father. His actual father is God the Father because Mary was impregnated by the Holy Spirit. But Joseph, was a poor carpenter. What religion tells us is that Joseph was just a poor carpenter in Nazareth. And Luke 4 states that Joseph was of the house and lineage of David. Although he was not involved in Mary becoming pregnant with Jesus, Joseph was descended from the house of David, as was Mary. So we've already seen that a clan of David's lineage moved to Nazareth in or about 100 BC, and the name Nazareth was derived from a Hebrew word that means a shoot or a branch, okay? It seems that Nazareth was so called because it was the village where a branch of David's lineage lived. Okay, scholars say it's likely that many members of David's lineage lived in Nazareth. So most people believe that in Nazareth, Joseph worked as a poor woodworking carpenter because Matthew 13:55 states in reference to Joseph that Jesus was the son of a carpenter. Okay, but the word translated carpenter in the original Greek language has different meanings. And this is important, y'all. You need to study the word of God. You need to study it to be approved and righteous and that you're using it the right way. Okay, you can't just read it for as it is. You have to study the Greek formats and understand it. That's why they make concordances, okay, to help us understand the original language. So the translation of the Greek word to our word carpenter misses the mark of the word's actual meaning. Okay, so for so long we believed that Jesus just lived in this poor family that was struggling, woodworking carpenters, barely eking by, and that Jesus was this vagabond, poor guy walking around, couldn't even barely find a place to live and things like that. You know, couldn't lay his head down anywhere. He had raggedy sandals on and raggedy robes because he was the son of a carpenter that didn't make any money. They were poor and that kind of thing. But the word carpenter used in Matthew 13:55 is translated from the Greek word tekton. Okay. So while it can indeed describe a woodworking carpenter, this is not the principal meaning of the word. It's highly unlikely that the tekton would have meant a woodworking carpenter in regard to Joseph because there was very little wood, okay, in that particular part of Galilee. So how can he be a poor woodworking carpenter if there's not really any wood? Houses and buildings were not made of wood, but of stone. And wood was actually sparsely used because there was so little of it. And you see in a lot of the movies, it's always him working with wood and all these big wood pieces. making furniture. So let's see what other skills a carpenter, translated from the word tekton, possessed in addition to working with wood, as most people imagine a carpenter would do. First, the word tekton is where we derive the word technology. And this word was used by famous Greek writers to depict the most technologically advanced craftsmen in the ancient world at that time. The use of the word tekton in Matthew 13:55 Artie tells us that Joseph did not simply possess rudimentary skills. He was a man with highly advanced technological skills. Okay, the word tekton itself comes from a verb that means to bring forth, and it pictures one who has expertise to envision and create with his hands a well-wrought final product. Okay, that's what the word tekton actually stems from. The word tekton is so connected to the idea of creativity that it was used by some ancient writers to depict literary giants and poets who produced masterful literature and poetry. Importantly, it was also used to depict one who could create wonders out of matter, or one who could manipulate materials in a marvelous way that surpassed ordinary technical skills. But most important of all, the word tekton, translated carpenter in Matthew 13:55, is a technical word to picture masterful artisans who had fabulous abilities to create masterful works of art. These works included, but were not limited to, intricately designed buildings, floors covered with magnificent mosaics, elaborate frescoes painted on walls, and sculptures carved from marble, sumptuous pieces of jewelry fabricated from gold or silver and then adorned with precious jewels, the use of ivory, especially in jewelry and furniture, and fabulously designed furniture that was embellished with ornate elements made of bronze, silver, and gold and adorned with precious jewels. So, sorry, guys. It's important to note that one scholar has said a tekton was so highly skilled that he could create shiny and splendid things of extraordinary beauty that made them appear to come to life. So the principal meaning of a tekton was one who was highly skilled, versatile craftsman or artisan who had the technical know-how to create wonders out of matter in hitherto unseen ways. So, you know, in the years before Jesus started his ministry, he was also known as a carpenter, but the word carpenter is translated from the word tekton. Doesn't that make sense, though? The creator of the universe was more than just a poor woodworking carpenter. He was a fabulous, technologically advanced artist of creating things, amazing things that nobody could have made. Oh, he created this world. Why can't he create amazing, fabulous things? Why does he have to be a poor carpenter, you know, working with wood? You know, I mean, and so we really need to be careful when we're trying to understand what the Bible says and the Word says, not to change it into what we think with our own finite minds, and really read what the Word says in the original manuscript and understand the truth. Because you know what? Jesus is amazing. And that's the truth. He's not just ordinary. He's an extraordinary person that came to live in an ordinary world. Okay? The truth will set you free. Know the truth. Guys, hey, we hope you have a great Christmas. Kelly and I are going to continue our celebration. God bless you.